Welcome to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute is building an interfaith coalition to defend the family. We believe the best for children is mothers and fathers who cooperate in a lifelong union of love, surrounded by a culture that supports these aspirations. You can count on the Ruth Institute to know what they're talking about, and you can count on Dr. J to help you put your faith into action and make a difference. This week, we bring you an expert who will help you in your stand for a civilization of love. The Reverend Dr. D. Paul Sullins is a senior research associate for the Ruth Institute. He recently retired as professor of sociology at the Catholic University of America in Washington, D.C. Dr. Sullins is a leader in research on same-sex parenting and its implications for child development. He is the author of 4 books and over 100 journal articles, research reports, and essays on issues of family, faith, and culture. Among many other positions of leadership, he serves on the board of the Center for Family and Human Rights, CFAM, and the Natural Family Journal. And he is a fellow of the Marriage and Religion Research Institute. Dr. Sullins is a former Episcopalian, now a married Catholic priest. And now, for Dr. J's personal interview with Father Paul Sullins.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse. Welcome to this edition of the Dr. J Show. Listen, I'm really excited about this program. Our colleague, Father Paul Sullins, has recently come out with a new paper on the impact of abortion on women's mental health long term. And he's got some very interesting results, and it's very relevant to this month of January 2020, wherein people are commemorating the Roe v. Wade decision here in the United States, and there are many pro-life activities around. So when you see this program and you hear what Father Sullins has to say, I do hope that you will share this with everybody you know, because these are some very important results that Father Sullins has. So Father Paul Sullins, Senior Research Associate at the Ruth Institute, welcome to this edition of the Dr. J Show.
Very happy to be with you, Dr. J, Jennifer.
All right. Hey, so Father Sullins, tell us, what is this new paper of yours? What's different about it? What's special about it? Why should pro-lifers be interested in it?
Well, if you're familiar with the statements from major social science agencies and medical agencies, the American Medical Association, the British Royal College of Surgeons, that tell us in different words that a woman who has an abortion of an unwanted pregnancy suffers no more mental health problems than a woman who carries such a child to term. And if you think about that statement, it seems to talk about all abortions, but in fact, it doesn't. What's subtly hidden in that statement is the fact that somewhere between 15 and 20% of all women who have abortions have an abortion of a child that later, when they're describing their pregnancy history, they say, that was a child I wanted to have, but I had an abortion anyway. And so what this study is, it is the first study that's ever looked at that class of abortions. And the reason I looked at it was that I thought, you know, if a woman has an abortion of a child that she wanted to have, even retrospectively looking back, she realizes that she wanted to have, that abortion is likely to be more traumatic, more distressing psychologically than the abortion of a child that she didn't want to have. And so if we ignore those abortions, it may be that we're underestimating the total risk of abortion. Now, I came at this following a study that I did 3 years ago, trying to estimate the population prevalence of post-abortion trauma. And I did that. The estimate is that about 9% of all distress for women in their late 20s at a population level is related to having had an abortion.
Holy, whoa. So all women, this is all women or all women who have ever had an abortion?
All women who have ever been pregnant
okay.
in the United States.
Okay. So if you take the set of women, all women who have ever been pregnant in the United States, mm-hmm. of all of the psychological distress that those women experience over the course of their lifetime, over 10 years, over
through,
what period?
Through age 28.
Through age 28 from, okay, then 9% of all distress is somehow related to post-abortion experience.
Right.
That was the estimate that you came up with then.
That was the estimate.
Okay. Right. And so in that study, you didn't have the opportunity to look at why exactly? What was driving that? Okay.
Right.
So this new study that you've got, tell us what you did in this new one.
Well, I took that same data and I separated out the women who reported that the fetus was wanted at the time of the abortion. I'm using the National Longitudinal Study of Adolescent to Adult Health,
right,
which is one of the top rated data sets in the world. It's well known to all researchers. I can see you nodding your head.
Right.
It's called AdHealth. There are probably thousands. I know there are definitely hundreds of scholarly studies that have been based on these data. It's been funded by a consortium of federal agencies. It's followed women for 13 years from age 15 to age 28.
Okay.
And, you know, lots and lots of things about the U.S. population in general, not just women, but men. It follows that whole set. And so I looked at these data, and they ask a pregnancy history of each woman at the interview. By the way, there's about 15,000 persons on the file. So it'd be about 8,000 to 9,000 women. We have about 4,000 to 5,000 women who are pregnant, and then factoring in all of the different non-response from the different variables, I have a sample of just over 3,900 women.
Okay.
That is in this set. So it's a large body of data by these terms. And so they ask each woman about her pregnancy history. Interestingly enough, they ask about it in the context of her relationship history. So they talk about, well, tell us about your sexual partners, your boyfriends, and then it's like, did you get pregnant with that one? And then they ask, at the time that you became pregnant, did you want to have a child? And if she says no, then that's coded as an unwanted pregnancy. But if she says yes, then that's what's called a wanted pregnancy. Actually, in the first couple of submissions on this paper, I said, well, this is a wanted child pregnancy, because the question is, did you want to have a child at the time you became pregnant? But that was ruled to be inflammatory by the reviewers, that you could talk about a pregnancy as a wanted child, because it somehow implies that that's a child there. Well, that was what the question was. So I just changed it to wanted pregnancies.
Hold on just
yes,
a minute.
Sure.
For those of you watching this program who are not at a high level of nerdiness like Father Sullins and I are, okay, you need to understand this is kind of how it goes back and forth with social
right.
science. Okay.
Yeah,
so
right.
so you're trying to be as precise as possible, and that's commendable mm-hmm. up to a point.
Right.
But you can see there's a kind of hair splitting that's gone on here. So for him to get his results out there, he had to be very particular about exactly what he said and so on. So anyway, continue, Father Sullins.
You're not allowed to refer to the unborn child in scholarly literature. You have to refer to the pregnancy or the fetus or something else.
Right.
But that's the secular environment, that we're trying to communicate to. I looked at these, they measured the wantedness of the abortion. And then they also, at each interview, by the way, they interview these women three times, at age 15, at age 22, and again at age 28.
Okay.
At each interview, they also ask a large barrage of questions that are related to psychological state and health. The questions are derived from the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of the American Psychological Association. And so they conform to the diagnostic criteria. They don't, you know, you can't diagnose women in a statistical interview, but it comes as close to measuring the level of distress in that population as you can possibly get. And so I took measures for seven psychological disorders. These were, I hope I can rattle them off here, depression, suicide ideation, that is thoughts of suicide, and anxiety. And those three I class together as affective disorders. And then four measures of substance abuse, abuse of alcohol, opioids, hard drugs like cocaine or opium or heroin, gotta look
doesn't
at it.
Matter doesn't yeah. matter
anyway,
we trust you that
marijuana
you can...
the other one's marijuana.
Okay so
we have these four substance abuse and four affective disorders, and so I was able to measure them at each point in time, and know the abortion and the pregnancy history of each woman at each point in time, and so from that I computed longitudinal statistical models that used information from all three waves and predicted over the period of time between age 15 and 28, any effect that a prior abortion would have on present distress. Was able to look at the difference between women who had not had a prior abortion and those who had had a prior abortion. And then within that second class, those that had an abortion of a wanted pregnancy compared to those that had an unwanted pregnancy. And was able to do so with a high degree of rigor and specificity. I won't bore your viewers with all the details of the study, but I controlled the findings for 20 different covariates that have come up in prior research that may be associated both with having an abortion or with having a problem pregnancy and with higher psychological distress.
Right.
And it would kind of undermine the results. So after all of that, I found that affective distress was much lower for women who aborted unwanted pregnancies, much higher for women who aborted a wanted pregnancy. Affective distress was elevated 18% for women if they had aborted an unwanted pregnancy. And that's compared to childbirth. So if they had, if they gave birth to an unwanted pregnancy or one or more unwanted pregnancies, they had lower affective distress. If they aborted those unwanted pregnancies, they had higher affective distress, but only 18%. But if it had been a wanted pregnancy, it was elevated 69%. That was really significant.
Whoa.
So there's a huge difference between whether or not the woman, looking back, said that she wanted to have that child or not.
So let me ask you this. Of the women who had abortions, roughly what percentage, retrospectively say, gee, I really wanted that child? How many people are we talking about here?
It's almost 20%.
I see.
Of all women who've had an abortion. It's 19 and change.
Okay.
Right. And about 15% of all abortions in the United States are of these wanted children or pregnancies that the woman looks back and says, I wanted to have a child. Now, that's in the Ad Health data. In the study, I cite some other data sets that have different estimates of that, and the estimates range from 6% of abortions are reported as of wanted children in the National Survey of Family Growth to data from Finland that reports that 25% represent children that were wanted.
So let's pause yeah. right here on this point, because yeah. for the person using this kind of information, the thing I'd like to point out is that we're bombarded with rhetoric about abortion and why women have abortions and so on.
Yeah.
And the mental model that we have is that women have abortions because they don't want the baby, or because the baby would be a big problem to them somehow, and that women are unambiguously better off right. as a result of having the abortion. I mean, that, I think, is the bottom line. that the abortion lobby and the sexual revolutionaries generally have tried to promote, right, that women are unambiguously better off from having an abortion. Father, yep, Sullins' data is calling that into question, at least for an important subset of women who have abortions. You can look at it and know for sure that that turns out not to be true. Now, why are you the first guy to ask this question?
Well, let me say first, it is a complete myth, a falsehood, that women are better off after having an abortion. That may be the popular conception, but in the scholarly literature that I study, there have been hundreds of studies of post-abortion distress. And the goalposts of those studies are that if scholars who are somewhat opposed to or neutral about abortion find that there's a lot of distress, statistically significant distress, following an abortion, scholars who are trying to defend abortion find that there's only a little bit of distress. But you know what has never been found in a single study of abortion? That following abortion, women's psychological health over the long term is improved. Never been found.
Unbelievable.
So there is absolutely no evidence. I challenge anyone to find any evidence that abortion improves women's psychological health in the long term. Now, there are some studies you can find that show that women have better educational attainment. They're, right, you know, if they have an abortion in grad school, they're able to finish getting that degree, that they may have better career advancement in some circumstances. But the women who have an abortion may make more money and have a better education, but they don't have better psychological health as a result of it. That doesn't follow in this, yeah, in this population.
Yes.
And so what happens is, and I used to say, well, you know, many studies have shown that educational attainment is better, but I was challenged on this and went back and looked at it and found, well, you know, those studies are also pretty weak. There are a few weak findings that show better educational attainment, but even if you follow that 5 to 10 years out, you find that those educational attainment lines come together. So a woman who doesn't have an abortion, has a child, may have to interrupt her educational attainment, but she usually goes back and gets it later.
Right. 10 years later, she's matched up with that, with where she was.
That's correct.
Right. Right. Now I'm gonna interrupt here now, because we're doing our nerd thing here, and Father, yep, Sullins and I are having a great time. We're having a great time with this, and I hope you all are too. But I interrupt this program with a message that says, it's a scientifically proven fact that most people are not persuaded by scientifically proven facts. So we have to tell a story. So I'm going to tell a story. I had an abortion in graduate school, and I was very distressed about it. I knew it right away that I was distressed about it. And I had multiple counselors telling me that my distress had nothing to do with the abortion. Mm. I had night terrors, meaning I woke up in the night terrified, short of breath. You know, I was depressed. I had anniversary anxiety. And only much later did I find out that lots of people have that. Okay. And so we know of people like Teresa Burke, who's a therapist, who discovered post-abortion trauma, in a sense, in one of her therapy groups. She had a group for women who had eating disorders. Mm-hmm. And a few months into that group, she found out that 5 out of the 6 of them had had abortions. And her supervisor forbade her to talk about abortion in that group, you see. So it was, for me, it was only when I came back to the Catholic Church, when I went to confession after 12 years to the priest who was the chaplain at George Mason University, and I'm allowed to reveal what I said. He's not allowed to reveal, but so I'll say Father Bob Solinsky is a great confessor out there, and he's still out there in Northern Virginia, and he brought me back to the faith. And honestly, I was immediately relieved when I said I did something wrong, and he said, you know, he didn't have to pile on, right, you know, he didn't have to say I did something. He said to me, "Do you think God can forgive you?"
Mm-hmm.
That, of course, I completely lost it at that point, you know. But that was the beginning of the healing, to face that something, you know, that I had done something wrong, that the reasons I gave myself were almost immediately revealed as not good enough reasons, you know. And over time, it just got worse and worse rather than better and better. So this big lie that we have in our culture that women are better off from their abortions, that women need unlimited access to abortion or they're all going to collapse mentally, you know, this is completely 180 degrees opposite. Yeah. Of the truth. Completely untrue. So let's review what we've got here.
Okay.
You've got about 20% of women who've had abortions will retrospectively say, yeah, gee, I really wanted that baby.
Yeah.
And regardless of the political correctness, a mother will call it a baby and not a fetus most of the time, you know?
Yeah, that's right. Actually, when they're not having to tick off boxes on a survey form, you just ask women, how do you feel about your abortion?
Or
whether it's prospectively or retrospectively, they'll almost never talk about unwantedness. They'll want to please the other people that are in their lives and talk abstractly or maybe not so abstractly about the baby. There's a lot of reticence and ambivalence and complexity for women following an abortion. It is the researchers, the dominantly secular researchers, that want to think that we can easily categorize women's pregnancies into wanted and planned or unwanted and unplanned.
Yes.
In fact, life is way more complex than this.
Yes.
And so when a woman goes into an abortion clinic, right, it's difficult for many people outside the United States to understand the level of kind of sales pressure, a kind of a coercion for her to be moved toward making a choice to have an abortion. Because abortion clinics, whatever they may claim, are in business primarily to do abortions.
Right.
And so when a woman gets in there, it's kind of like a treadmill that's leading her toward an abortion. It's one of these things that you talk about in your book, that of the sexual revolution that just moves us toward destructive things. So, you know, there's a system that moves people toward divorce when they have marital troubles. And there's a system that moves women toward having an abortion when they have some difficulties with their pregnancies. And so what happens in the United States particularly is that women get pushed into making these choices for abortion and then look back later and say, you know, I didn't really want to do that. And
right.
Some of that is buyer's regret.
Yes.
That just like if somebody buys a car that they didn't want to get. In a recent study, for instance, of the abortions in Utah, where they looked at the effect of just a 3-day waiting period, they found that just having that little timeout period, 8% of the women who initially had wanted an abortion changed their mind.
Yes.
And said,
yes,
I do not want to have that abortion. Well, that's a large rate of pulling back just in those couple of days.
So let me ask you this. When you look at the women who say they wanted the child, What else do we know about those women? Do we know anything about their relationship status, or you know, whether it was their boyfriend pressuring them, or is there something? Were they mentally unstable in the first place? Because right. Sometimes that's a claim that's made about these data. The women who feel bad would have felt bad anyhow. What do we know about those women?
The number one reason, most common reason that a woman reports such things is that although she wanted to have the child, someone else in her relational system or support system did not. Her boyfriend did not, or her parents did not. And so she didn't feel that she could go ahead and have that child without that support. Or she didn't want to disappoint them, or she didn't want them to think that she was overly selfish or to be cut off from them, or you know, all the other things that she may risk in order to do that. That's the most common reason. I'm sure there are other reasons. One thing that is not prominent among wanted child abortions numerically are fetal abnormalities.
Mm-hmm.
And I say that because the American Psychological Association sort of assumed or inferred that all abortions of pregnancies that were wanted were due to some problem, some medical problem with the pregnancy. But I examined that claim in the study. And if you look at the rate of fetal abnormalities and our ability to detect fetal abnormalities, they could only account for a very small fraction, not more than 10% mm-hmm. of the number of wanted child abortions that are reported in these data. Mm-hmm. So there are some trisomy 13 or other difficulties where parents choose Down syndrome, parents choose to have an abortion. And some of these are due to that, but only a very small proportion of them.
Now, throughout the literature, there's been this claim that the people who are psychologically distressed after their abortion are people who already had a prior history of depression, right. or psychological distress. Did you find support for that claim in the data that you have?
No, I went to great lengths to rule that out.
Is that so?
As I said, we have excellent measures of psychological state at each of three waves, beginning at age 15. And so I was able to look, say a woman at age 28 is reporting higher depression. I was able to look, did she have higher depression before she got pregnant or had an abortion? Was she more depressed at age 15? And I controlled for all that to rule out those factors.
Yes, yes. Yeah. And you know, in my book, The Sexual State, when I wrote this book, I knew that the studies would be out of date pretty fast, you know, just because of the nature of the kind of thing. The structure, the analytical structure is sound and it'll be there for 50 years. But the longest section in this book is the propaganda about the contraceptive ideology, because the propaganda supporting the contraceptive ideology is immense. And to help people identify that, you know, so this claim that abortion is harmless is part of the propaganda that says sex is a sterile activity, and you don't have to be concerned about children, and you don't have to be concerned about whether your partner would be a suitable co-parent, and so on and so forth. Abortion being harmless is a central part of that. And I remember when I first looked at this, I highlighted this. Researchers in the early 1990s took measures of emotional functioning 30 minutes after the abortion and at the 3-week follow-up appointment.
Right.
When I first saw this, I thought it was a joke because that was their idea of a long-term study at that point.
And this is because to this day, most secular researchers conceive of an abortion as a clinical event only. And so it's what happens in the experience at the clinic or the hospital, and that's what they want to know the reaction to. They do not conceive of the way that choosing an abortion and having an abortion can alter a woman's entire life path and life course, so that she has to deal with the way that changes her relationships, that changes her own vision of herself, and all of the other difficulties, psychological changes that come as a result of making that choice, right? Most of the so-called distress of having an abortion, in my study, is comparative distress to having a child. And it's not the case that having an abortion increases a woman's distress compared to what it would have been had she not had the abortion. What really happens is that carrying that pregnancy to term and having a child reduces her distress. It creates psychological benefits that she misses out on if she has an abortion. I call this the opportunity cost of an abortion.
Right.
She loses the opportunity to have the child. And I go into this in some detail in the study. Most of the pro-abortion scholars deny that having a child is of any psychological value to a woman. That's because they're professionals in a very technical career, and having a child wouldn't be any particular benefit to them, they think.
Right.
But in fact, a woman who has a child 10, 15 years after that child, it is blessed, is benefited in any number of ways having that child. So in my data, the abortion, apart from childbirth, of an unwanted child, which would be the most conservative case if you're talking about abortion trauma, only increased difficulties by about 5%, and not really significant. But carrying that child to term instead reduced difficulties by 29%.
Right.
And so what happens is that when you compare the two, the woman is better off having that child.
Right.
And so that's the real harm, if you will, the relative harm that comes from abortion is that it warps a woman's outlook on life. You were talking earlier about your spiritual experience. If you think about it, God is our Father. He is constantly generative. And when we turn off our generativity, we deny our fertility, then we become in that action separated from God. We become warped in our own life. We turn inward, selfish. We begin to make choices that will deny us the kind of relationships and experiences and growth toward holiness that God has intended us to have. And so women who have abortions make that choice and wander off that path. It's not to blame them. Most of them don't even know. They don't recognize what's going on. But it takes them down a path that ends up in much more hurt than would have happened otherwise. And so far, in objective scientific studies, the longer we follow out that hurt, the time since the abortion, the more hurt that we find.
Wow. So, you know, two thoughts come to mind. First of all, you started off by saying that the typical secular scholar views the abortion as a clinical event and doesn't look at what happens out afterwards and outside, except that they will look at it as how it affects her career and her education, right? So the whole, you know, as an economist, the way I look at this is that the whole economy has adapted to and built itself around contraception and abortion, so that postponing childbearing is the price of entry into many of the professions. So that part they'll see, but they won't see this other part, right? Yes. This other long-term outside the clinic aspect of it. The other thing that I notice about what you said is how mechanical one view of the human person is and how spiritual and multi-layered the Christian position is. The Christian position is that the human person is meant for love and that at the heart of the universe is an unending love that generates all of us, you know, and that we get to participate in that and that the sexual power is sacred because it is part of that generative power of God. Well, when we cut off our fertility, you know, when we're more afraid of our fertility or we limit our fertility, that's what we're cutting ourselves off from.
Yeah.
So this has many, many layers of meaning, I think.
Right. I'm aware of those economic claims and women who had an abortion, no doubt. If you have an abortion, it's likely to further your career.
Right.
Just like there's no question that the chances for advancement in a career, particularly if it's a highly demanding, competitive career, can often improve by removing inconvenient persons in your way,
right,
whether through divorce or through character assassination or taking credit for somebody else's work or having an abortion, right?
Right.
Now, most people who are successful don't, you know, boast about their brutality to others along the way, but sometimes women do about an abortion. But really, it's not a positive character of a person or of our culture or society that can happen. Probably more men have encouraged their partners to have an abortion that would be inconvenient to their career than women for themselves. But for either one, neither of them have no way of knowing what would have happened if they had accepted and loved that terminated life, which is a close reflection of their own being.
Right.
And it's not just this stranger that's being killed. It's someone who reflects you as closely as any human being will ever do that. It's self-destructive.
I noticed this when among people who have postponed their first child and they only have their first child when they're 35, then they go,
yeah,
holy, Well, why did we wait so long?
Right.
What exactly were we waiting for? You know, as a culture, we used to get people started, you know, and say, well, let's get on with it. You know, you're ready. You don't have to wait till you're 40. You know, let's get on with it. But we don't do that anymore. And so by the time people figure it out for themselves, their capacity to make further choices is pretty limited because you run out, you know, the biological clock has kind of run out. So, so it's a disservice to people to be doing that. Anyway, you know, we had this recent episode of an actress proclaiming the value of her abortion very recently. I think you had, did you look at Michelle Williams's comments and what did you see in those comments?
This is an example of someone who is, you know, proudly boasting about a kind of brutal act, removing somebody that was in her way, and claiming that as something positive and good. But, you know, she has no way of knowing what her life would have been like had she accepted that child.
Yeah.
What would have gone in it? And it is. Someone raised this issue with me, and I looked at her statements. Maybe if she'd had the child, for all she knows, her career may have been improved.
Right.
Maybe her career would have suffered, but her life and happiness would have been improved. What a shallow judgment to say, oh, well, I have more prestige. I've made more money, so my life is worth more. That's a very shallow assessment of life. And, you know, we have no way also of knowing what pain and struggle may lay behind her kind of defiant public mask.
Right.
I noticed in reading it that she called out to her living children at the end, saying, well, I love you. I can't wait to be home with you. But why did she feel the need after announcing her abortion to reassure her children and us of her love for them? Did she sense that they... and we might wonder about that. It's also appropriate to ask, you think about, we're in the Me Too era. Who was the father of the child
right. That
she felt the need to abort?
Right.
Would presenting this man with a child after having sex with him have impeded her career? Was that the problem?
Yeah.
The abuse of male sexual exploitation doesn't just end with hurt feelings for the woman. It also ends with death for the child in many cases. Now, maybe this wasn't her case. Maybe it was a different situation. But,
right. You
know, for the career obstruction for both men and women of having a child at the wrong time is the mirror image of the career and personal obstruction for women presented by refusing to have sex with the right man or the wrong man at the wrong time.
Wait, what do you mean by that? What do you mean by that?
Well, saying to a man, I'm pregnant, and that might create problems that's going to impede someone's career,
mm-hmm.
is just a further step. Right? And so you have to have an abortion. You're not able to bring that child to birth. That's just a further step of not being able to say to that man when he wants sex, no, you can't have sex. Right. That's also going to impede your career.
Right? It might, right.
So if you're thinking about things that are going to advance your career, and having abortion is one of them, well, also submitting to sex relations with the right kind of man is also something that would advance your career. Now, I'm not saying that she necessarily did this, but the statement that she makes reflects a world where women's sexuality exists primarily to serve male desire.
And see that, I don't see how people cannot get that. You know,
yeah. You know,
it's presented like it's to serve woman's desire.
I know.
But all too often it's the man's desire that ends up being served, and the wrong kind of man. You know, this is like men at their worst, right? The Harvey Weinsteins of the world are the ones who get away with things that no one should be allowed to get away with because we have this view that sex is a problem-free, child-free, guilt-free entitlement.
Two things are definitely linked to one another. But in that world, right, women have very little agency.
Right,
the
right.
The only thing a woman can do in that world that would be successful would be to become like a man.
Right.
To have the same kind of success that a man has.
And that you can look at that on the economic side, you can look at that on the sexual side. That's what we've been offered. That's what equality means, is that we gotta fit ourselves into that.
And you're in a very competitive, hard-driving situation, both career-wise and also with respect to these sex relations with men. So the other side of a woman later in her career, like Michelle Williams, saying, well, I'm proud of the abortion, and by implication of the sexual behaviors that preceded the abortion that brought me to where I am today, is a woman earlier in her career who's saying, I have to give in, I have to put out in order to advance in the career. And even in personal relationships, many women express this. I remember, and I don't remember exactly who said it, but a younger Hollywood actress who made a great effort to go be with her boyfriend while she was filming somewhere else and asked why. She said, well, I have to give him what he wants or else he's going to go get it somewhere else. And so there is this pressure, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
For women, a lack of agency to service male desire when you separate sex from the consequence of having children.
Right.
Because really, having children is the nobility, is the fertility and the agency of women in that relationship, and the consideration and the care for the child, the realization that this child is going to be the common offspring of the man and the woman that's going to reflect both of their lives is what draws them together and keeps them together. When you separate those two, then men have much less interest in being with that woman for anything other than the animal urges of the moment. I'm not saying that's always the case, but there's much less kind of natural incentive or agency for that to be there. And the people who hurt the most in that, by far, are women, because women bear that child in their own body. They are connected with that child, whether or not the man is still in the picture or not. And so for a woman to deny that physicality, that primal connection with her children, is for her to want to become like a man, to deny her womanhood, and she loses her agency as a woman in that relationship.
And you know, part of what's going on as well is that the whole thrust to say we have too many children, we have too many babies, we need to control the population, that is part of what has gone into the educated mind, you know, the highly educated person who's listened to a lot of this type of stuff and heard a lot of these type of arguments. To see a child as a good, as a gift from God, that's a much bigger stretch for somebody with a doctorate a lot of the time. Whereas for a person who has a job, not a career, the impact of the child on her life is much more unambiguously positive. You know, it can be a source of esteem and connection and love and all, there can be all kinds of goods that she can immediately experience and see and connect to. Whereas, you know, if you're part of this kind of educated class that is trying to control the population, you just can't see it. It's a lot harder to see. And I want to say one thing about the men, if I may, Father. The men are suffering too, but it's harder for them to see because they're not maturing the way they should. You know, they're not, by not assuming the male responsibility, the paternal responsibility, they're being robbed of something as well. And it's not the case that men are just all walking away from the responsibility. In some cases, it's being taken from them, you know, that they would like to assume those responsibilities. And for a variety of reasons, you know, they're not being permitted to.
It's probably more common for a man to want to have the child and be denied because the woman makes a choice.
Do we know anything about that statistically?
Well, Catherine Coyle, you know, has studied this, and I don't know the exact data on it, but it's fairly common, relatively common, I would think, for a man to be thwarted because he has no choice in having the abortion, technically, legally. Well, he has a lot of influence on that woman, obviously, but many men report that they were robbed of their offspring. Because they found that the woman, they didn't even know she was pregnant and found out later that she had had an abortion And there's a lot of feelings about that. So, but it happens with women too. And that's kind of the thrust of this particular study. I would like to say one more thing about Michelle Williams, because someone said, doesn't this disprove your study? And I said, well, no, not at all. In fact, it proves it, because obviously the child that she aborted, that pregnancy was not a wanted child. That was an unwanted child. And the results of my study show that if a woman aborts a child that she looks back and says, well, that was unwanted, she's much less likely to feel affective distress about that than if it was a wanted pregnancy. So actually, she illustrates pretty well the results of this particular study. What I would say is she's just not representative of all abortions, or
that's the point.
A typical abortion.
Right. That's the point. We the sexual revolutionaries do this all the time. Here's the storyline.
Right.
And the storyline is that if you do what we say, everything's going to be great. And if you do what we say and it's not great, it's your fault. So if you are distressed about your abortion, you would have been distressed anyway.
Right.
You were already distressed. You were already upset. You know, it was your fault. It was somehow your fault. We see with divorce. Hey, blended families are no big deal. If it's a big deal, it means your family's uncool. Get it together. You know, stop complaining. So what we're trying to say to the public here with this type of evidence is that we're being bamboozled. The sexual revolutionaries are giving us this kind of cardboard cutout view of the human person, and saying, if you do these things which are non-traditional but which fit into our brave new world, you are going to be happier. Well, it doesn't take too many counterexamples to disprove the claim. And we got tons of counterexamples. You know, we got counterexamples all over the place of women who experienced abortion and were not better off. And Father Sullins is telling you that the best women typically do is break even. They're not made better off by their abortion.
Right.
In comparison with actually giving birth to the child. So if you start thinking about that and you say, well, what we really want to do is improve women's well-being, what you really need to be doing is attaching men more securely to their sex partners in the first place, and be committed to the person that you're having sex with, so that if you have an unwanted pregnancy, it won't be a complete disaster.
That's right.
You know, that's what you need to do.
And widespread legal abortion has not made women more free.
That's right. Our society
has not made our children more loved, has not created a kinder, gentler society. It has done just the opposite.
Right.
So the main point that I make at the end of this study and every similar study, and I'm not the only one that has made it, is that the whole ideology of the therapeutic abortion, which is the justification in most Western societies for having abortion so freely available, it has no basis in evidence. After 40 plus years of the experience of abortion in the United States, we can't find any societal benefit for women to being able to have abortions. It leads to less happy women and a harder, more coarse social fabric to a sexual domination of women by men. All of the things that people were trying to improve by pursuing this by pursuing abortion. So that is the main point, and I hope that as we look at a world where we may be restricting abortion legally more than we do today, we'll understand that that is not going to take away some valuable prop to women's freedom and liberation. In fact, it's going to do the opposite. It's going to help bring men and women back in line with their natural selves, with the way God has intended us to relate to one another, and make a society that is more loving, more caring, happier, more fulfilled for men, women, and particularly for the children that result from them.
You know, usually we like to give action items for people at the end of these interviews, and I think what we're going to do is make some images of some of your results and put them on Facebook and ask people to share those images, you know, just looking at some of the statistics. Now, you know, since I have you here, there's one other thing I want to ask you about, and that has to do with contraceptive failure rates. So we were looking at, you sent us to this article that was published in the New York Times that had this kind of spiffy graphic that where you could run your mouse over the thing, and you could see over a period of time what percentage of people would end up with a pregnancy if they were using a particular method.
Cumulative failure rates,
The 10-year failure rate, according to that, so that seems like a reasonable thing. According to the New York Times, the 10-year failure rate of the pill was about 60%.
Yeah.
Meaning that at the end of 10 years of using the pill, 60 out of 100 women will have had at least one pregnancy.
Right.
Now, and you know, what they'll show you when you go into a Planned Parenthood clinic to get your contraception, they'll show you a little table that says, oh, about 8-10% failure rate in 12 months. What they don't tell you is every 12 months you got that failure rate.
Right.
If you do it long enough.
That's right. In fact, they'll tell you that the failure rate is less than 1%, which is what it is in the laboratory when all the conditions are perfect.
Right.
And they'll say, you know, do your best to make it as perfect as you can. They won't tell you that, you know, you're going to forget to take your pill, or you're going to lose it, or it's, you know, it's going to lose its efficacy, or you're going to get a bad batch, or, you know, whatever all the other things are that can affect that failure rate in actual practice. But that's what really is important.
Right.
And so what you and I both know, it is shown by those graphics, and that is that contraception is a myth. You really can't prevent conception reliably, even with modern technology. We are no more advanced than they were in the 18th or the 17th century when they used what we think of as primitive forms of trying to prevent conception. In actual practice, in fact, one of the best ways to prevent conception is natural family planning, which it only has improved over the years and the decades as people have gotten better techniques with it. It's not perfect, but it's certainly as good or better than the birth control pill in actual practice. And so the lesson is, if you're going to have sex relations as a man and a woman, you should be prepared to have a child.
Right, right.
You're welcome to try to prevent that, to forestall that. But if you're going to do the deed, you're going to probably conceive a child. That's what it's made for.
Right.
And so that's why the church, in its great love and wisdom, says, well, you shouldn't engage in that activity until you're married, because marriage is what builds the context of a relationship and a life in all ways, economically, emotionally, for welcoming a child into the world.
That's right.
And not saying, oh, that child is a surprise and inconvenient. Intelligent people know that it's not a surprise. In fact, it's what it's all about.
Right.
Yeah.
And you know, so when you look at that, if you look at that New York Times graphic, we're going to post it up here so people can see it.
Yeah.
It'll show natural family planning or something like that. That's one of the methods. And it's 85% failure rate, blah, blah, blah. You know, and it looks terrible. But here's the difference. You only practice natural family planning with somebody you're married to.
Right.
So if you have a failure, it's not that big of a deal. It's not the same level of problem as if your condom fails you with a guy that you picked up at a bar. You know, I mean, it's just a different level of problem because the social context is so completely different.
Right. You can't imagine people meeting occasionally for casual sex practicing natural family planning. It just doesn't. It wouldn't work in that kind of relationship. No. It's made for faithful marriages. And we recognize that it's not an absolute prohibition or in some cases, in our cases, we tried natural family planning in order to enhance fertility, right?
Right.
We can also do that. But it doesn't guarantee results one way or another.
That's right.
It helps you work with God to kind of increase or decrease your chances. So I think it's very appropriate for the way that we're made. and for the focus of our lives, which really should be on our offspring when we get to this point in our life that we're grown and we're married.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. It shouldn't be all about us anymore.
No.
No.
And when we make it not all about us, we find that we grow and we develop as human beings much better. We become much happier as, you know, billions, I guess, of parents throughout time and history have attested to. It's what we're made to do. We think we're giving something away and we're losing something, that this child is invading our lives in the modern world. But in fact, the child is rescuing, is redeeming our lives, is helping us to become more than we can be.
You know, it's funny what you said, that by releasing ourselves or letting go of ourselves, we find ourselves. Wasn't there some smart guy once who said something along those lines? But I mean, it's a constant theme of the Christian message that in dying, we're born to eternal life. By losing yourself, you find yourself. In giving, we receive. As St. Francis paraphrasing of the gospel there, that and parenthood really illustrates that very well. And we've lost sight of that. And so therefore, we have we've created a lot of other problems for ourselves. Father Sullins, thank you so much for spending this time with me and the Ruth Institute followers. I think people are going to really be blessed by this program and by the information that you've shared with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jennifer. Great joy to be with you.
Thanks.
You've been watching Dr. J's personal interview with the Reverend Dr. D. Paul Sullins. Mother Teresa once said, "The greatest destroyer of peace today is abortion, because it is a war against the child, a direct killing of the innocent child, murder by the mother herself." And if we accept that a mother can kill even her own child, how can we tell other people not to kill one another? And now for the most important part of our program, your action item for this week. Visit the Ruth Institute on Facebook and share our memes, which illustrate Father Sullins' research proving that many abortions are of wanted children and that abortion harms women's health and well-being. Just go to the web address below and be sure to share with as many as possible our memes. And that's our action item for this week.
Praise God. Amen. You may be seated.
The message we carry and we bring is good news. We champion life over death. The reason we oppose abortion is because we believe in love. We believe in life. We believe in truth. Kindness over cruelty. Mercy over any law. So our message is one of hope and one of light and one of love. We believe life is sacred, precious, holy, created by the personal hand of Almighty God. All life, no matter what circumstances. If a woman is horribly, tragically raped and there's a baby conceived, we believe that that baby was conceived in the mind of God before all eternity, before the universe was created. God creates intentionally. There are no mistakes. You know, there's slogans you can see. God don't make no mistakes. Well, that's true. And if we really believe that, we will oppose all abortion anywhere for any reason at any time because God makes no mistakes. It is God who creates the precious life in the womb. But we stand against abortion because we believe in love. We believe that love heals. Abortion is violence. Giving birth is love. It is the definition of love, self-sacrifice. It means giving of oneself. That is how we grow in love. We believe in hope. We believe hope is eternal. We believe in truth. So we stand against abortion because we follow this life and love and hope and truth embodied in our Savior, Jesus Christ.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.